In just a few minutes. Call right now.
Call 800-378-3818. 800-378-3818. 800-378-3818. That's 800-378-3818.
This is the Money Matters Radio Network. WBNW 1120 AM and W275 CM FM. Concord, Boston. The Money Matters Radio Network.
Thanks to dedicated members across the nation, the DAV programs are far-reaching and the personal rewards fulfilling. Our members are diverse in their interests, which is what has made the DAV so successful. Foremost in our hearts is the goal of assuring benefit entitlement and compassion for our disabled veterans. For more information, visit DAVMA.org. That's DAVMA.org.
There are many ways to protect your assets from the nursing home. If you use a life estate, that can create problems, including the possibility of losing control over your estate. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699 or request it online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated.
We are the Debt Destroyer Network. Any debt you have, credit card, tax, student loan debt, call now for free information that helps you destroy your debt. It's great advice. Plus, when you make this free call now, we have debt destroyer experts ready to help. They can show you how to destroy your debt and get your life back on track. Debt problems don't have to be overwhelming. You can live stress-free and debt-free. Credit cards, medical bills, IRS tax problems, even student loan debt. Learn about free programs offered by the credit card companies, hospitals, and even the government that can help slash your debt. Call the Debt Destroyer now for free information. Call now. 800-430-8804. 800-430-8804. 800-430-8804. Again, that's 800-430-8804.
This is Tucker Silva of the Financial Exchange Show, and I'm joined today by estate planning attorney Todd Lutsky from the law firm of Cushing & Dolan with your Financial Exchange Quick Tip of the Day. And today, we're talking about the use of life estates and your primary residence. Todd, what are the pitfalls associated with creating a life estate when you transfer the remainder interest to your children?
Yeah, you know, this is the most common way people create life estates. It seems easy, it seems simple, but it's not the best way to create a life estate. Once you put your children's name on the deed, you give up a lot of control. Like you can't change your mind later if you want to leave it to one child versus another who might be taking care of you later. You have problems if you want to go to sell it, right? You might have the right to live there, but if you want to go to sell it, you're going to need the permission of the children in order to sign off on the remainder interest of the deed. And then even if they do sell it and you get their permission, a larger chunk of the proceeds are going to end up in the hands of the child rather than you. That creates adverse income tax consequences to the child, plus you, who sold the house, might need the money to buy another house or a downsized house or move, all of which create problems, never mind creditor problems for the children while they're living. Folks, don't do the life estate this way because it seems to create more trouble than it's worth.
Learn how you can avoid probate, eliminate estate taxes, keep your money in your family, and protect your assets from the nursing home. Request this brand new guide from Cushing & Dolan. It's called Calculating the Consequences of a Life Estate. Call 866-848-5699. That's 866-848-5699. Or you can simply request it from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com.
The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated.
Is there anything better than sitting on a beautiful beach watching the sunset with an ice-cold drink? You can experience that right now by booking your next vacation to the United States Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John are all unique in their own special way. And if you head to usvi.com, you can create the vacation of a lifetime. Whether it's the rich history of St. Croix, the pristine beaches of St. Thomas, or the spectacular nature of St. John, the USVI has a little bit of everything for today's traveler. Upon arrival, you'll fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no money to exchange, no passport required, and travel from New England could not be easier. Make your plans now by going to usvi.com. Whether it's a romantic getaway or a family vacation, the U.S. Virgin Islands has everything you need to enjoy. The vacation of paradise is waiting for you. So head to visit usvi.com for more information and to reserve your trip today. That's visit usvi.com. The Financial Exchange is produced by Money Matters Radio and is hosted by employees of the Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor that provides investment advisory services. All opinions expressed are solely those of the hosts, do not reflect the opinions of Armstrong Advisory or anyone else, and do not guarantee profit. Investments can lose money. This program does not offer any specific financial or investment advice. Please consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong and Money Matters Radio do not compensate each other for referrals and are not affiliated.
This is the Financial Exchange with Chuck Zotta and Mike Armstrong. Your exclusive look at business and financial news affecting your day, your city, your world. Stay informed and up to date about economic and market trends, plus breaking business news every day. The Financial Exchange is a proud partner of the Disabled American Veterans Department of Massachusetts. Help us support our great American heroes by visiting DAV5K.Boston and making a donation today. The DAV 5K Boston is presented by Veterans Development Corporation. This is the Financial Exchange with Chuck Zotta and Mike Armstrong.
Chuck and Mike here with you, along with Tucker. And when we take a look at markets here, facts are very simple, and this is data from the Wall Street Journal. The S&P 500 poised for its best start to the year since 2019. Now, Mike, I got to talk to you about something.
Please.
I was told that because the first 3 days of the trading year were down, that we were in for a really rough time this year.
Yeah.
I was told things were going to be very bad.
The groundhog didn't see his shadow, too, so we got to account for that in markets. Yeah, it turned out that wasn't terribly predictive, was it?
No, as it never is. So this is something that I'm going to harp on here, because it's something that we covered because people wrote about it. And I did a little bit of research, not really research. I typed into my email, you know, I was looking for stuff from the first week of January, so I just did a search there. And I'm going to quote here from the same Wall Street Journal, same publication. So I'm not, you know, hopping around and, you know, trying to pull anything here. Major indices have pulled back in the first three sessions after ending 2023 with a bang. The S&P 500 is down 1.7%, its worst start to the year since 2016. The Dow Jones Industrial Average declined 0.7%, and the NASDAQ has dropped 3.3%. Of course, 3 days of returns means little for long-term investors, but many are already pondering whether the early year sell-off marks a blip or the start of a longer downturn. The Stock Traders Almanac has popularized the theory. As goes January, so goes the year. If January is positive, that's putting money to work, said Joe Ferreira, investment strategist at Gateway Investment Advisors. They're telling the Federal Reserve, the economy, the companies they're investing in, that they think they can grow for the year. And so 3 days in, where the market was down less than 2%, looking at the S&P 500, you had entire pieces being written about, hey, this could be a bad year for stocks.
Bogus.
And look, it still may turn out to be, because we're through almost 3 months. Today's the last trading day of March, tomorrow being Good Friday. So there still is a ways to go. But I just want to point out what markets have done to this point. The S&P 500 up 10.1%.
Is that good? Did I break it?
It's at an annualized pace. If this were to keep up, we'd be running almost 50% for the year.
Yeah.
Which is fine. The NASDAQ 100 up 8.75%. Dow Jones Industrial Average up 5.5%. NASDAQ Composite up 9.34%. Russell 2000, even those pesky small caps that, you know, have just been kind of like, you've been poking them and you're like, hey guys, do something. Do something. Up 4.31% year to date. So this is why I think that reading financial news is bad for you. I'm almost serious. I'm like 93% serious on this.
Yeah. there is a lot of pride of diving into the Wall Street Journal and people that do so, and the more I go there, and Wall Street Journal is just the first one that I'm bringing up here, but there are plenty of much guiltier publications out there. A lot of the stuff that gets written these days is clickbait garbage that can do you harm.
If you want to read economic news where it's, hey, this happened, that happened, here's this deal, here's what the data came in at, I don't have any problem with that. But when you get into this stuff like, hey, markets are down for the first 3 days of the year, what is it? Honestly, digitally crumple it up and throw it in the trash can.
Yeah.
It's useless, and it just makes you feel bad because I don't know why, and this might just be where I've gotten to also in life, but I don't know why it seems like all financial media is rooting for the bad thing to happen also.
Mm.
Again, we had three down days to start the year, and you get, well, you know, we don't know if this is a blip or the start of a longer-lasting downturn. It's 3 days. It's literally nothing. It's literally nothing. So I think that the problem that I have with pieces like this is they get you all like, oh, no, this is going to be bad. And two things happen. Either, like, in the worst-case scenario, hey, someone reads this and says, oh, gee, like, it's I'm too nervous. I got to abandon, you know, the plan that I've put in place and whatever. And then they miss out on gains.
Mm.
The other piece just that's more common, I think, is you read something like this, and for some reason bad news does tend to stick around in our heads longer, like fight or flight response, like evolution, whatever it might be. Like, we're just wired to be, like, always looking for threats. And then you just can't appreciate the fact that this market rallied 10% in the last 3 months. And
doesn't ring true. Yeah.
And here's the thing. There are plenty of times when actual bad stuff does happen and when markets perform badly. Look at this third quarter of last year. Start of August, the S&P 500 was at like 4,600. It went down to 4,100 by the end of October. Like, that's a time where you say, hey, it's not 3 days, it's 3 months and the market lost more than 10%. This feels bad. Like, that's a time where you're actually like, yeah, this was, you know, uncomfortable. We didn't like this. But to have, like, three bad days that just happen to be at the point in time where the Earth is at the same spot around the sun where it was 365 days ago and be like, oh, like, this matters more than anything. Hogwash, poppycock, baloney.
But it gets written about as though it is statistically significant. And that's the real problem that I think exists. That's the problem that Mark Vendetti has brought up, is like, don't write me an article that is phrased as though it's a scientific paper when it's 10 paragraphs of how you personally feel about the stock market with no statistics to back it up.
I actually have something great to talk about along those very lines. Brent Donnelly, who's one of my favorite market commentators and traders out there, he has a daily newsletter that I'm going to read something from because it's not, well, he put it in there, but it's not his work. So if you look over the last 45 years, Mike, who gets ripped on for being inaccurate just as much as economists?
Jim Cramer.
Outside the financial industry.
Weathermen.
Bingo.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
and women. Sorry. Go ahead.
Wait, what?
Weather men and women.
Oh,
weather people.
I thought you were throwing a general women in there, and I was like, I don't know where this is going,
no,
but it's
sorry.
Not good. Okay.
No.
In any case, the accuracy of weather forecasts, and this is according to data from the European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecasting, the ECMWF,
yes,
who I follow very closely,
very
obviously.
Very common acronym.
So here's the thing. The three-day forecast has generally been fairly accurate. Even in 1981, it was accurate to within about 90% of the time. Today, the three-day forecast is accurate as far as, again, like, broad weather. Like, not like how much snow are you going to get, but like, will it snow, will it rain, will it be sunny, is accurate almost 100% of the time.
Hmm.
Almost 100%. The five-day forecast back in 1981 was accurate around 70% of the time. Today, it's accurate around 90% of the time. the 10-day forecast back in 1981, only accurate about 20% of the time. Worse than a coin flip. Hey, like, literally,
yeah,
we got no clue. Today, accurate about 45% of the time.
So still a coin flip.
But, again, that's getting every day right, so actually getting 10 coin flips in a row, right? It's impressive.
Yep.
The point I'm making here is that weather forecasts have generally improved over the last 40 years because they're focused on, like, 3 to 10 days. Hey, what's going to happen then? The problem with economics, and this is a point that Brent makes here, is if you look at, like, the 1 to 2 year forecasts from the CBO or basically anywhere, and you look at their error, it hasn't improved in the last 45 years. And the point that he makes is, look, you generally have a pretty good idea of what might happen over the next 3 to 5 days because you have set starting conditions, not too much is going to change over that time, and even though it's a complex system, you can work it out. Trying to build a 2 year forecast for anything is pretty much useless because random crap can happen that throws you for a loop that you just have no idea is coming. A bridge gets run into by a 100,000-ton ship. Okay, that's probably not going to change much this week, but who knows what the long-lasting impacts of that are over the next year or two. We got no idea. And so the point that Brent makes is that much of economics and market forecasting is actually pseudoscience and not real science because it's focused on stuff that you, quite honestly, you just have no possibility of predicting because it's so long-term. Whereas weather forecasts that are actually useful, hey, 3 to 10 days, great, we can kind of figure that out. His point is kind of like, stop trying to focus on things that are, you know, that far out. And honestly, it's kind of where I've landed too, which is, hey, you got a general idea of where things might be like 3 to 6 months out in the economy. When people ask me, hey, what do you think is going to happen over the next year? I have no idea.
I guess the other, just before we go on, the other key difference there, I would challenge anyone out there to give me a 3-day forecast for the Dow, S&P, and NASDAQ.
So you
right, like that's, I mean,
you. No, I'm not saying that you can get it like 100% right because you can't. But I'm saying it's easier to predict shorter term things that happen in markets in the economy because you're starting from a fixed point
where
not that much weird stuff can happen.
Yeah.
Like I know, hey, we've got, you know, X data releases this week. Here's what's projected. Here's how they may move. And you can make an informed decision there. Trying to predict like the inflation rate in October of this year.
Useless. I'm with you.
How would I do that?
I'm with you.
How would I do that? Let's take a quick break here. When we come back, we'll stop ragging on, you know, financial publications for...
I don't want to rag on financial publications, but when we come back, I want to talk a little bit more about the dot-com comparison that's being made a few times here in this market. There's a piece about, you know, JP Morgan talking about stocks being crowded, and I just want to dive in on a couple of recent events in terms of the AI phenomenon that's going on right now and the comparisons being made to the dot-com phenomenon 20 years ago, if we can go there next on the Financial Exchange. Sound good?
Let's do that when we come back.
Missed one of our shows? Catch up anytime by asking your Alexa smart speaker to play the Financial Exchange. This is the Financial Exchange Radio Network. Is there anything better than sitting on a beautiful beach watching the sunset with an ice-cold drink? You can experience that right now by booking your next vacation to the United States Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John are all unique in their own special way. And if you head to usvi.com, you can create the vacation of a lifetime. Whether it's the rich history of St. Croix, the pristine beaches of St. Thomas, or the spectacular nature of St. John, the USVI has a little bit of everything for today's traveler. Upon arrival, you'll fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no money to exchange, no passport required, and travel from New England could not be easier. Make your plans now by going to usvi.com. Whether it's a romantic getaway or a family vacation, the U.S. Virgin Islands has everything you need to enjoy. The vacation of paradise is waiting for you. So head to visit usvi.com for more information and to reserve your trip today. That's visit usvi.com.
To be engaged, you must feel included and valued.
The DAV Department of Massachusetts nurtures a culture where inclusiveness is a reflex, not an initiative, where there's a deep sense of pride, passion, and belonging that is unified in our shared commitment, dedication, and patriotism for our country. We know through experience that different ideas, perspectives, and backgrounds create a stronger and more creative organization that delivers better results for the veterans and families we strive to assist. For more information, visit DAVMA.org.
There are many ways to protect your assets from the nursing home. If you use a life estate, that can create problems, including the possibility of losing control over your estate. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699 or request it online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated.
Everyone has financial goals, and regardless of what yours are, the process of establishing a comprehensive financial plan is key to achieving them. This is Chuck Zotta from the Armstrong Advisory Group, and our new guide called Building a Financial Plan may help. Some goals are bigger than others, like saving for retirement, but even smaller goals like paying off your credit card debt can be an important part of a well-rounded financial plan. As you build your plan, break your goals down into realistic tasks, establish a saving strategy, or determine an asset allocation that aligns with your risk tolerance. It's also important to create checkpoints to help you monitor your progress and make sure your plan remains on track. Call us today at 800-393-4001 and ask for our new guide called Building a Financial Plan. That's 800-393-4001, or you can request it at armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services. A sound estate plan has many layers. In some cases, using a life estate can be a beneficial piece of your plan, but they also can be problematic. Call Cushing & Dolan, the experts in elder law, at 866-848-5699 and request their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. In it, you'll learn about the significant issues that life estates can cause, including the possibility of losing control of your estate. Building the proper estate plan not only protects your assets from the nursing home, but also helps you avoid probate and potentially eliminates estate taxes. So be aware of the many problems life estates can cause before you create one. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699. Or you can request the guide online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. That's LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated.
The Financial Exchange Show podcast drops every day on Apple, Spotify, and iHeartRadio. Hit that subscribe button and leave us a five-star review. You're listening to the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
All right, Mike, you had some thoughts on J.P. Morgan's comments that I'll quote from their analyst, Dubravko Lakos Buhas.
Wow.
Very actually, nice. Hang on. It's spelled differently in two paragraphs right after each other, so I don't know if it's Lakos Buhas or Lakos Buhos.
J.P. Morgan doesn't even know his name, apparently.
From J.P. Morgan.
Yeah.
In any case, it might come out of the blue. This has happened in the past. We've had flash crashes. One big fund starts de-levering some positions. A second fund hears that and tries to reposition. The third fund basically gets caught off guard. The next thing you know, we start having a bigger and bigger momentum unwind. Mike, is this useful information?
No, not in the least. And look, J.P. Morgan and their CEO have been pounding the table for a couple of years now, talking about how the economic cloud and hurricane is coming, and it hasn't. So I don't find any of this to be useful. What I do find interesting are the comparisons to today versus 2000 and the dot-com bubble. And Chuck, tell me if you've heard this argument from some. Yes, there are, you know, comparisons to be made in terms of stock prices, but the difference in 2024 is that we don't have all of these pets.com and companies with no revenue, never made a profit, going public and shooting up and skyrocketing into the cloud and taking off in ways like we saw during the dot-com bubble with small cap stocks that nobody's ever heard of, but you slap a dot-com on the back of it and it takes off. That was one of the things that I think has been mentioned as a pretty critical difference between that point in time and today's infatuation with artificial intelligence. Is that fair to say?
Yeah.
Last couple of weeks, we've had a couple of publicly traded companies start going public. One of them is a company that's been around for nearly a couple decades. They lost $90.8 million in the last year and did experience some revenue growth, but lost $90.8 million. The other one was a social media site, actually both kind of quasi-social media sites. This one lost around $49 million on $3.4 million in revenue. I'm talking, of course, about Reddit and Truth Social, both of which went public via different means and took off in early trading. I wonder... We are nowhere, again, near to the volume of companies that were doing so back in 2000. But the more and more I hear about the differences between today and dot-com bubble, the less I'm buying them.
Well, I think there are a few things that we need to clear up about the dot-com bubble first. The first piece is this idea that it was just these unprofitable companies that rallied tremendously.
Right.
Wasn't the case. We've covered the case of Intel before, which if you look back to, you know, how profitable they were back in the late 1990s and things like that, just as an example, Intel back in 2000 or 99, trailing 12-month profit, not revenue, but profit, was $7.3 billion. So it was a hugely profitable company. But Intel stock, when we look at the actual, you know, price of it, it went, you know, from in 1998 $21 a share up to 75 and change a share by August of 2000, tripling in a 2-year period.
Yep.
And ultimately, it has never gotten back to those prices. It's not because Intel went out of business because they were a badly run company or a pets.com or a CMGI or one of these, you know, entities that couldn't make money. They have made a boatload of money historically. I mean, Intel, like, you actually talk about, you know, their net income over time, and the only time that they have ever not been profitable, aside from a very brief period in 1986, is the last year. Other than that, their profits have actually consistently increased from that $7 billion mark in 99 up to north of $22 billion in 2020.
Right. People were just paying too much for their stock at that point in time.
So it's not just, when we talk about comparisons to the tech bubble, it's not just, hey, there were a bunch of these unprofitable companies, and once that washed out, everything was fine. It was also, there were some really profitable companies that were just crazily overvalued.
Right.
Microsoft is another one that you can look at, where, again, one of the biggest companies on the planet right now, and it hit its, you know, 2000 valuation of, I think it got up to like $60 a share or something like that. It didn't get back there until 2016. You know, it took almost two decades, and it's not because Microsoft was unprofitable. Microsoft is a company that has never had any losses as a publicly traded company. They've never posted anything other than a quarterly or annual profit. And in fact, their profit in December of 99, their 12-month profit, was about $8.7 billion. By the end of 2017, it was $26 billion. Their profit tripled over that decade, and the stock only barely got back to where it was. Not because it's a bad company, but just because it was crazily overvalued. So when we talk about those tech bubble comparisons, yeah, we've got a direct one in Intel to NVIDIA. We've probably got another one with Microsoft to itself. It doesn't mean that those stocks are going to go that route, but it's a possibility to consider. Quick break. Wall Street Watch is next.
Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at TFE Show. Breaking business news is always first, right here on the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
Is there anything better than sitting on a beautiful beach watching the sunset with an ice-cold drink? You can experience that right now by booking your next vacation to the United States Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John are all unique in their own special way. And if you head to usvi.com,
you can create the vacation of a lifetime. Whether it's the rich history of St. Croix, the pristine beaches of St. Thomas, or the spectacular nature of St. John, the USVI has a little bit of everything for today's traveler. Upon arrival, you'll fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no money to exchange, no passport required, and travel from New England could not be easier. Make your plans now by going to usvi.com. Whether it's a romantic getaway or a family vacation, the U.S. Virgin Islands has everything you need to enjoy. The vacation of paradise is waiting for you. So head to visitusvi.com for more information and to reserve your trip today. That's visitusvi.com.
The stock market recently reached all-time highs, but with the volatility we've seen over the last several years, there are no guarantees it'll stay there. This is Susan Powers from the Armstrong Advisory Group. While job growth is strong and inflation has declined, the past few years have shown us how rapidly conditions can change, which is all the more reason for you to have a financial plan in place that is built to withstand the ebbs and flows of the stock market. Our new monthly guide is called Building a Financial Plan, and in it we discuss the process of putting that plan together, including the importance of setting goals from paying off debt to saving for retirement, as well as a variety of additional planning strategies. Call our office at 800-393-4001 to get your new guide today, or you can request it online by visiting armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services.
Hey, listen, are you a 50-year-old person looking for term life insurance? Then you need to talk to Bob. Bob specializes in helping people find $1 million or more of term life insurance for a couple of $100 a month. Look, you need to know there's a price war in the term life insurance business, and you may be paying too much. Call Bob, and he'll shop and see how much money he can save you. Look, this could be the last term life insurance policy you ever have. Your rates are guaranteed for the next 20 years. That's right, guaranteed level rates for the next 20 years. And if you're a smoker or your health is not perfect, Bob has great rates for you too. So for $1 million of term life insurance coverage for a couple of $100 a month, call Bob right now.
800-965-7987. 800-965-7987. 800-965-7987. That's 800-965-7987.
Paid for by Term Direct.
Hi, folks. Susan Powers and Chuck Zotta here from the Armstrong Advisory Group, and we're talking today about our brand new guide for the month of March, Building a Financial Plan. Chuck, why is it important to build a financial plan?
Well, I think it's something that can give you some important guidelines as far as what you should be doing on a daily, weekly, and monthly basis in order to be able to hit those goals, and whether those goals are saving $100 into an emergency fund or trying to save thousands of dollars for a college education that may be coming in 15 years, you still need to have a plan for how to execute that on a daily basis in order to get wherever you want to be going.
So we know how fluid life can be, Chuck. What happens if you need to change your plan because your circumstances change?
Well, I think this is one of the most important things, is that a plan is just an initial guide for what you should be doing. But if things do change, you have to adapt that plan as well. So let's go back to what I was previously talking about with saving for college. If the picture for how expensive college is going to be in the future changes because of changes to student loans or things along those lines, you might say that you need to adapt your plan and change your savings strategy, and that's perfectly fine to do if the reasons, you know, for doing so make sense and if the picture is different from when you initially started building that plan.
Folks, learn how you can develop a comprehensive financial plan to help you pursue your goals, whether they are modest or substantial. Call right now to request your free copy of our brand new guide, Building a Financial Plan, at 800-393-4001. That's 800-393-4001, or request your free copy at armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services. Time now for Wall Street Watch. A complete look at what's moving markets so far today, right here on the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
Well, on the final trading day of the first quarter, markets today are really flat as Wall Street readies for tomorrow morning's core PCE index inflation reading. Right now, the Dow is down by 28 points, S&P 500 is up by 2 points, and the NASDAQ down by 7 points. Russell 2000 is up by about a third of a percent. 10-year Treasury yield flat at 4.20%, and crude oil up just over 1%, trading at $82.32 a barrel. Shares in Walgreens down by a quarter percent after the retail pharmacy giant beat fiscal second quarter sales expectations. However, the company lowered the high end of its fiscal 2024 adjusted profit guidance, citing a challenging retail environment in the U.S. The company also posted a steep net loss for the quarter as it recorded a hefty goodwill impairment charge of nearly $6 billion related to its primary care provider, VillageMD. Meanwhile, Home Depot announced this morning it will acquire SRS Distribution for $18.25 billion, marking the home improvement retailer's largest acquisition in the company's history. SRS Distribution sells supplies to professionals in the landscaping, pool, and roofing business. Home Depot shares down by 1%. Elsewhere, Estee Lauder received an upgrade from Bank of America to buy from neutral, noting the cosmetic maker's profitability recovery efforts, new products, and improving share in the prestige beauty sector. That stock up by 5%. Luxury furniture retailer RH missed on both top and bottom lines in the fourth quarter. However, the company is forecasting better than expected revenue growth this year due to improving demand trends. RH shares are up by 17%. And as a reminder, U.S. markets will be closed tomorrow in observance of Good Friday. I'm Tucker Silva, and that's Wall Street Watch.
Mark, there. Not Mark. Mike.
What's my name?
I don't know anymore. Piece in the Wall Street Journal. When can I collect Social Security, retirement's biggest gamble? And it's talking about the idea that, hey, a couple things factor into this. The first is, what is your full retirement age? And that has varied over the last decade based on when you were born. As an example, if you were born between 1943 and 1954, your full retirement age is age 66. Well, you're also well over age 66 right now, so doesn't really factor in. And that moves all the way up to those born age in 1960 or later. Full retirement age is 67. So the last, you know, adjustment that we have is basically completed in 3 years. And then everyone from then on, their full retirement age is age 67. But this impacts when you're able to get, you know, your full benefit and how spousal benefits are impacted. There's a whole lot that plays in. But remember, you can collect anywhere between age 62 and 70. And the right amount to collect or the right time to collect, you don't know it unless you know the exact date you're going to die, because that's basically when you can figure out, hey, did I make the right choice or not?
Yeah. So when you're talking about, hey, if I want to maximize my total benefit, then that's, yeah, it's impossible to know because you don't
your
know
lifetime benefit.
You're going to die. Your maximum lifetime benefit. You don't know how long you're going to live, so you can't possibly know. But when tackling this subject, you know, for some people, it's really purely that question. It's, I've got enough money elsewhere to afford my retirement. And if you're in that position, then yeah, it's like this guessing game of longevity. But for some, it's kind of a different story. And let me play it out this way, right? Like everybody probably cringes at the idea of kind of what I consider to be a really bad case scenario where you wait all the way until age 70, you collect this robust Social Security benefit, and then really sad case that I ran into just recently. Somebody got a terrible case of cancer and they collected 1 month of Social Security benefits. It was heartbreaking. But I think it's also important to acknowledge that in some people's cases, the risk to their overall financial scenario is not passing away earlier than expected. While that's right, devastating, it didn't leave this person in a financial scenario where their spouse was going to run out of money. It did not leave their kids in this terrible position financially. It left them in all sorts of emotional devastation, but it did not ruin them financially. What may ruin some people's personal finances is instead living till the age of 100 and pulling Social Security at age 62. Yes, those Social Security benefits at 62 are still adjusted for inflation, but if you're starting at 62 at a much lower starting point, then that's going to not keep pace with inflation the same way that delaying all the way to age 70 would be. And so as much as that first scenario that I painted is devastating to people and frustrating and disappointing, you also have to consider, like, what's the real risk to my overall financial scenario? What am I trying to accomplish with this decision other than just maximizing my benefit? Because in some cases, you have other things to consider here in terms of ensuring that your retirement actually works. I know that this is a complicated formula, set of rules. It really impacts everybody differently depending on how long you worked, where you worked, if you took time out of the workforce, maybe you worked in education or as a police officer, all these different rules. They're really, really complicated. But again, a financial advisor's job is to help you assess that and not make the decision based on what your uncle did or your neighbor did who might have the same job, but how it actually applies to your personal situation. And if you're trying to assess that, whether it's with your Social Security or any other part of your financial life, I encourage you to reach out to a financial advisor. And the folks at Armstrong Advisory Group are more than happy to talk to you about this decision-making process. You can reach us at 800-393-4001. Again, that's the phone number for the Armstrong Advisory Group. And the number is 800-393-4001.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services.
I want to talk about a piece in Bloomberg that I found kind of interesting. Larry Fink, who runs BlackRock, basically put out a piece that says, "Hey, baby boomers, we've got to fix the retirement system that we built because otherwise no one's going to believe in it." And he's not wrong.
I've got a different practical reason that they should fix it.
Because otherwise it's not going to be feasible for many people to retire?
That, but like also, do you want millennials fixing your retirement system?
Well, like, it depends.
There's an argument, but do you want, you know, the elected officials that are 20 years younger than you or 30 years younger than you being the ones that are deciding how your Social Security retirement system is going to fund itself for the future? I would think not. I would think that...
Do they exist?
I would think that...
Do what exist?
Millennial
lawmakers.
No, we have a pretty old legislative body. But again, we're talking about 8 years from now before this thing runs out of official funding. And I don't know, were it me, I would not want my kids' generation deciding how it's going to be funded.
I don't know, the idea of an avocado toast on every plate sounds appealing to me.
Right? I don't know, that's just, I'm not trying to utilize scare tactics here, but like, practically speaking, maybe you want the people who are also going to be impacted helping you make the decision on it rather than just burying their head in the sand.
Oh, yeah, because you play out the string here. So 8 years from now, when Social Security, you know, the trust fund runs out of money and benefits are slashed by a little more than 20%, you do the math out. So it's 2032. The last baby boomers were born in, I think it was, is it 51 or 54 when the baby boom ended?
I'm sorry, I don't have the answer readily
available. Any case, the youngest baby boomers at that point are going to be like 80. So they're not going to be the ones that are, you know, dealing with the nitty gritty of this, because the oldest baby boomers are going to be in their 90s. And look, I don't know how to say this without being ageist, so I'm just going to say it. When you're 90, you don't want to be solving complex political problems that impact hundreds of millions of people.
I'm sorry, but when you're 80, you just don't.
Like, you just don't want to be doing that.
Lead
okay?
a country.
If I were 90, I would hope that the rest of the country would not be relying on me to solve problems either.
Yeah,
like it's just how it is at that point. I don't know any better way to say it. But here's what I do think is I do think that we have these problems that are solvable. And the problem, as Fink rightly points out, he's like, look, we keep kicking this can down the road and millennials think that we're idiots. And granted, like, we're not idiots. Like, that's not what it is. But they think that all we are is like self-interested and that we don't understand the problems and this and that. And if we can actually go and fix this, then we'll regain, you know, a little bit of trust in the system and in us, and that'll help, you know, the overall trust in capitalism as a system that can move forward.
That's kind of the point that I was trying to allude to without putting it bluntly. Like, there is a lot of mistrust between the millennial generation, maybe some Gen X, and the baby boomer generation. And so for many reasons, but that one included, I really think that you want to try and solve this problem sooner than later.
Well, and Mike, if we're talking about, like, wealth transfers created by Congress in the last two decades, it's because they, I'm sorry, once again, to put it bluntly, they've all been from millennials towards baby boomers. The Affordable Care Act, one of the big things that it did was it shifted the maximum ratio of basically how much insurance companies can charge people in their 60s compared to in their 20s. It used to be, I believe it was 10 to 1. It's either 5 to 1 or 3 to 1 now, meaning that if you're in your 20s, you now have to pay more compared to what you previously would have, and that means that people in their 60s have to pay less. It's a transfer from younger to older. The other two pieces, the Secure Act and Secure Act 2.0, both of those pushed back required minimum distributions, meaning that baby boomers don't have to pay as much in taxes. In turn, they reduced the amount of time available for inherited IRA recipients to withdraw the money, making them do it over shorter and shorter periods, as opposed to over the length of their lifetime, meaning that millennials have to pay more in taxes upon withdrawing that money.
Now, I happen to think those are good rules, but that's what they were. They were
right.
Transfers.
Correct. I don't think there's anything that's inherently bad about this, but if you look at, like, the last, you know, few major pieces of legislation that have changed these things, that's generally what has happened. So I think if we're talking about, like, hey, how do we fix Social Security and how do we fix 401k plans and this and that, it's a real problem that's out there, and the clock is ticking, and baby boomers have a chance to fix this because, by and large, they still control the levers of power in the United States. But the clock's ticking. Like, there's an 8-year clock on Social Security to fix this. And we're not getting there. And we're also all not getting any younger.
We're not even really making any constructive progress either. I guess the best thing I can say about progress is that I think this is the third article I've seen this week on fixing Social Security. So if you want to call that progress, I guess we'll start
there. If we write it about it enough, that'll fix it maybe. Let's take a break while I get some avocado toast, and when we come back, we'll talk a little bit about gas prices and why they've been rising faster than usual this year.
The Financial Exchange streams live on YouTube. Like our page and stay up to date on breaking business news all morning long. This is the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
Thanks to dedicated members across the nation, the DAV programs are far-reaching and the personal rewards fulfilling. Our members are diverse in their interest, which is what has made the DAV so successful. Foremost in our hearts is the goal of assuring benefit entitlement and compassion for our disabled veterans. For more information, visit DAVMA.org. That's DAVMA.org.
There are many ways to protect your assets from the nursing home. If you use a life estate, that can create problems, including the possibility of losing control over your estate. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699 or request it online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated.
Is there anything better than sitting on a beautiful beach watching the sunset with an ice-cold drink? You can experience that right now by booking your next vacation to the United States Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John are all unique in their own special way. And if you head to usvi.com, you can create the vacation of a lifetime. Whether it's the rich history of St. Croix, the pristine beaches of St. Thomas, or the spectacular nature of St. John, the USVI has a little bit of everything for today's traveler. Upon arrival, you'll fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no money to exchange, no passport required, and travel from New England could not be easier. Make your plans now by going to usvi.com. Whether it's a romantic getaway or a family vacation, the U.S. Virgin Islands has everything you need to enjoy. The vacation of paradise is waiting for you. So head to visitusvi.com for more information and to reserve your trip today. That's visitusvi.com.
Everyone has financial goals, and regardless of what yours are, the process of establishing a comprehensive financial plan is key to achieving them. This is Chuck Zotta from the Armstrong Advisory Group, and our new guide called Building a Financial Plan may help. Some goals are bigger than others, like saving for retirement, but even smaller goals like paying off your credit card debt can be an important part of a well-rounded financial plan. As you build your plan, break your goals down into realistic tasks, establish a saving strategy, or determine an asset allocation that aligns with your risk tolerance. It's also important to create checkpoints to help you monitor your progress and make sure your plan remains on track. Call us today at 800-393-4001 and ask for our new guide called Building a Financial Plan. That's 800-393-4001, or you can request it at armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services.
It happens all over Massachusetts.
Can you tie my shoes?
In every home and every community.
Be careful on your bike.
Learning can happen anytime, anywhere.
Hi, guys. We'll see you at practice this weekend.
And no matter how learning takes place in your family's life, DESE is there as your partner. The Massachusetts Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. Never stop learning. Find out more at mass.gov/back to school.
Sponsored by the Massachusetts Department for Elementary and Secondary Education.
For 40 years, Cancer Support Community has been a relentless ally for anyone impacted by cancer, with free services provided online and in person, with their newest location in Massachusetts. Connect with Cancer Support Community Massachusetts for free emotional support, educational resources, patient navigation, financial counseling, and more. 617-797-3391. CancerSupportMass.org. CancerSupportMass.org.
This is your home for the most comprehensive coverage of the economy and the trends on Wall Street. This is the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
This segment of the Financial Exchange is brought to you in part by the U.S. Virgin Islands Department of Tourism. Visit the U.S. Virgin Islands and enjoy your next incredible vacation. Explore St. Croix, St. Thomas, or St. John and enjoy pristine beaches, world-class dining, and fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no passport required or money to exchange. Go to visitusvi.com and book your trip today. That's visitusvi.com.
Mike, let's talk a little bit about prices of La Gasolina. So we've seen gas prices rising pretty quickly over the last few months here. Where we're seeing right now, the AAA national average is up to $3.54 a gallon, and that is up about 14% since the start of the year. It's varied based on the different part of the country that you live in. Utah, as an example, has seen their gas prices rise by 63 cents a gallon over the last month. That is the fastest pace in the country. And you've got, you know, other areas that obviously have been slower, if that's the fastest pace in the country.
Slower pace, got it.
Exactly. But when we look at this, what we've seen is that since the beginning of the year, the cost of gasoline shipped into New York Harbor has increased by 28% over the first 3 months of the year. That's compared to 20% on a normal year. And so the question is, why, Michael?
Are we going to try and get into predicting gas prices, or are we just trying to explain what has been the move so far?
Let's explain what has been, because who the heck knows where they're
going to
go?
Yeah, I want to start there. Like, anybody trying to predict where oil prices are going has been horribly bad over it and about it, and for good reason. It's really difficult to produce, to predict. But there's been severe weather, geopolitical disruptions abroad. I don't think I have to tell anybody about the war in Israel or the most recent terrorist attack in Russia, all, you know, partially contributing to higher oil prices as well. And then there is some seasonality to this as well. As you pointed out, first half of the year can see higher gas prices, but they have been rising faster than normal. So better than expected economy, I think, is there too, right? You have a China that is not floundering quite as much as it was last year. Is there anything else that you would point to that's sizable?
Europe's showing signs of economic growth.
Yeah,
it's, you know, Europe's been mired in, you know, not not like widespread awful recession, but just kind of no growth and, you know, sporadic dips into negative growth here and there. And you're seeing some signs that Europe might be breaking out on that front. So, yeah, if you've got some worldwide demand that's picking up and you're not necessarily seeing production ticking up to match, it's kind of what you would expect, right?
Yeah, not terribly out of anticipation, but also I don't think anybody should be looking at this and saying this is where all other prices are going. That's traditionally not the case with gasoline prices or oil prices. That is why the Federal Reserve tends to discount the movements of these things when looking at their own forecast for where inflation is going. On the other hand, I will also say that there isn't a price that more negatively sticks in people's minds than moving gas prices. And so this could potentially be an issue for people's expectations around inflation, sure, as well as just how they feel about, you know, where the economy is going. We've seen how people respond to higher gas prices, and it's not overly positive.
Mike, I want to switch gears and talk a little bit about the upcoming April Fool's holiday.
Oh, yes, please. I got to think of some new pranks because my kids keep telling everybody about all the pranks that I've already done, and I can't just keep doing them because they're going to remember.
So I think the big thing that I want to talk about here is, do you think that the fast food minimum wage law in California going into effect on Monday is just an April Fool's joke?
Unfortunately not. Actually, fortunately not. Like I've said, I'm very excited about this.
So this law goes into effect on Monday in California. It is a $20 minimum wage for fast food workers, defined as workers who work at a restaurant that has more than, I think it's 10 locations in California and more than like 35 nationwide or something like that.
So I guess I have further questions about that. Does that mean that Chili's are fast food restaurants in this definition or not?
I believe they are. No, because it's not full service. It's not table service.
Okay, so if you have table service...
Yes, table service does not qualify as fast food.
But if you go up to the counter, even if it's a nice go up to the counter, then I am a fast food establishment. Okay.
So the minimum wage for the rest of California, $16 an hour. And so we are going to see this fascinating experiment that most likely results in some clear arguments as to why you shouldn't micromanage your economy on an industry-by-industry basis. It's coming Monday. We'll probably have some fantastic research on this in the next year or two. Quick break here, hour two of the Financial Exchange coming up.
This is Tucker Silva of the Financial Exchange Show, and I'm joined today by estate planning attorney Todd Lutsky from the law firm of Cushing & Dolan with your Financial Exchange Quick Tip of the Day. And today, we're talking about the use of life estates and your primary residence. Todd, does the 5-year waiting period for Medicaid eligibility apply to the creation of a life estate?
Well, the short answer is yes, it does. But let me explain why it does. So first of all, when you create a life estate, again, the general way people do it is they tend to put the remainder interest of the property in the hands of children. I don't like it that way, but that's how they do it, when you could have the remainder interest with a trust. But the moment you put the child's name on the deed and you reserve the right to live there is a completed gift for gift tax purposes. No one thinks of that, but now you technically need to file a gift tax return. And it's that creation of the gift, it's that transfer of that remainder interest in the property to the child for less than fair market value that triggers the disqualification period for Medicaid. So that's why you have to wait 5 years after you create this life estate arrangement in order for the house to be protected from the nursing home. It's very hard to avoid the 5-year waiting period, folks. There's really not too many ways around it.
Learn how you can avoid probate, eliminate estate taxes, keep your money in your family, and protect your assets from the nursing home. Request this brand new guide from Cushing & Dolan. It's called Calculating the Consequences of a Life Estate. You can get it by calling 866-848-5699. That's 866-848-5699. Or you can simply request it from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com.
The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each each other and are not affiliated.
Are you retired like me and you just found out you owe the IRS a ton of money? Well, what would your life be like if they took your retirement savings away from you? They can do it, and your property. If you owe the IRS back taxes or you haven't filed in a while, the Tax Relief Line is here to help you. They can stop the IRS from taking your retirement savings. If you qualify, you could have your tax bill reduced to zero. That's right. If you're retired and you owe the IRS a lot in back taxes, you could have your entire tax bill reduced to zero due. The IRS has now hired thousands of new employees, so they're ready to come after you. Don't let them take your retirement savings or property. Make this free call now.
800-251-2153. 800-251-2153. 800-251-2153. That's 800-251-2153.
This is the Money Matters Radio Network. WBNW 1120 AM and W275 CM FM. Concord, Boston. The Money Matters Radio Network.
Do you use the expensive blue or yellow pills to charge your sex life? Are you thinking about it? What if we can promise you the same results for less than $3 a pill? If you're paying $20 a pill for the other pills, you're getting taken to the cleaners. Our pills deliver the exact same results for less than $3. You'll save more than $16 a pill for the same results. And right now, radio callers will get 44 blue or yellow pills for $120 with free discreet shipping. You can save more than $700 off pharmacy prices. Charge your sex life now and save a ton of money. Call now and get your 44 pills and save over $700 and qualify for free shipping. Stop overpaying and call right now.
Paid for by Steel Man Pills. 800-475-8547. 800-475-8547. 800-475-8547. That's 800-475-8547.
If you served in the Marine Corps, by now you know about the contaminated water problem at Camp Lejeune. If you were stationed or worked at Camp Lejeune from 1953 to 1987, you probably have a lot of questions. We have some answers. You could be entitled to compensation. Billions of dollars are being allocated to pay for damages to anyone stationed at Camp Lejeune during that time. Unfortunately, it appears that officials may have known the contaminated water problem existed and did little to protect their men. The Semper Fi Code was not honored. If you or someone in your family has developed a serious illness, including various forms of cancer, call this Camp Lejeune legal support line right now. You can't turn back the clock and change what happened, but you can certainly call right now and learn your rights as a Marine. Here's the number.
800-477-1736. 800-477-1736. That's 800-477-1736. Paid for by Legal Alert Line.
With the stock market remaining volatile, it couldn't be more important to have a sound financial plan. I'm Mike Armstrong from the Armstrong Advisory Group. There are risks with any investment strategy, and that's why we've written a brand new guide to help you understand those risks and how they can be associated with any financial decision. It's called Building a Financial Plan, and it may help you recognize the potential risks and rewards that are associated with your investment strategy, in addition to offering insight into how to research making the decisions that are best suited for you and your family. The guide also provides information on how to establish clear financial goals and what steps might be needed in order to achieve them. Call us today at 800-393-4001 and ask for your free guide today. That number again is 800-393-4001, or you can request it online at armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services.
To be engaged, you must feel included and valued. The DAV Department of Massachusetts nurtures a culture where inclusiveness is a reflex, not an initiative, where there's a deep sense of pride, passion, and belonging that is unified in our shared commitment, dedication, and patriotism for our country. We know through experience that different ideas, perspectives, and backgrounds create a stronger and more creative organization that delivers better results for the veterans and families we strive to assist. For more information, visit DAVMA.org.
There are many ways to protect your assets from the nursing home. If you use a life estate, that can create problems, including the possibility of losing control over your estate. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699 or request it online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated. Is there anything better than sitting on a beautiful beach watching the sunset with an ice-cold drink? You can experience that right now by booking your next vacation to the United States Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John are all unique in their own special way. And if you head to usvi.com, you can create the vacation of a lifetime. Whether it's the rich history of St. Croix, the pristine beaches of St. Thomas, or the spectacular nature of St. John, the USVI has a little bit of everything for today's traveler. Upon arrival, you'll fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no money to exchange, no passport required, and travel from New England could not be easier. Make your plans now by going to usvi.com. Whether it's a romantic getaway or a family vacation, the U.S. Virgin Islands has everything you need to enjoy. The vacation of paradise is waiting for you. So head to visit usvi.com for more information and to reserve your trip today. That's visit usvi.com. The Financial Exchange is produced by Money Matters Radio and is hosted by employees of the Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor that provides investment advisory services. All opinions expressed are solely those of the hosts, do not reflect the opinions of Armstrong Advisory or anyone else, and do not guarantee profit. Investments can lose money. This program does not offer any specific financial or investment advice. Please consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong and Money Matters Radio do not compensate each other for referrals and are not affiliated.
This is the Financial Exchange with Chuck Zotta and Mike Armstrong. Your exclusive look at business and financial news affecting your day, your city, your world. Stay informed and up to date about economic and market trends, plus breaking business news every day. The Financial Exchange is a proud partner of the Disabled American Veterans Department of Massachusetts. Help us support our great American heroes by visiting DAV5K.Boston and making a donation today. The DAV5K Boston is presented by Veterans Development Corporation. This is the Financial Exchange with Chuck Zotta and Mike Armstrong.
Chuck, Mike, and Tucker with you here on the last trading day of March. Tomorrow being Good Friday, markets are going to be closed, even though we get the most important data release of the week with PCE inflation data being released on Friday. I don't know why they couldn't have just released that today.
I'd be asking too much, Chuck, you know?
I kind of like that it's going to occur when there's no trading happening. Give us a few days to let it seep in and not react immediately.
Yeah, that'll be fun.
Yeah. Yeah, I like it. No, I'm good with markets being closed on the same day as the economic release.
Why don't we just have markets closed all the time? You can never buy or sell.
Yeah. Go the China method. Things getting too scary, just shut it down.
Close the market! In any case, today we've got markets basically doing absolutely nothing. It's just they might as well close it today because the Dow is off 4 points. The S&P is up 4 points, and the NASDAQ is up half a point. Not half a percent, half a point.
Yeah.
So there's not much going on there. 10-year Treasury is up 0.4 of a basis point. Very useful day. Oil, up $1.25. Okay, at least you get a little bit of movement there on West Texas Intermediate, now up to $82.60. And we got gold up $21.90 an ounce to $22.34 an ounce currently. So commodities making a little bit of a move, even though nothing else is. I woke up this morning and I saw this story from TechCrunch and I immediately sent it to Tucker because, my goodness, it's been a while since we could just rip on Mark Zuckerberg. It's been a while. You know, back in 2022,
prime time,
we were relentless. We had like a whole voice for how dumb the metaverse was. It was just nonstop, like, hey, your stock is tanking, you're spending billions on the metaverse that no one wants. Man, what are you doing? And then in the last couple of years, it's been, hey, you know, your stock is recovering, blah, blah, blah. Yes, you're still spending on the metaverse, but who cares? and, you know, Zuck kind of trying to take on a little bit of a like an elder statesman in the tech space, you know, kind of vibe. You know, hey, I'm a changed person now. Like, no major controversies.
Not wearing the gray hooded sweater anymore.
No,
very
no.
fashionable these days.
Then we have this. I'm going to quote here. In 2016, Facebook launched a secret project designed to intercept and decrypt the network traffic between people using Snapchat's app and its servers. The goal was to understand users' behavior and help Facebook compete with Snapchat, according to newly unsealed court documents. Facebook called this project Ghostbusters, in a clear reference to Snapchat's ghost-like logo. So I won't go through all of the detail in here just because it would be boring, but the basic premise here is this is what is known as a man-in-the-middle attack, where you have encryption that is running end-to-end on a server and an end user. And basically, someone hops in the middle, hence the term man-in-the-middle, in order to intercept the data and somehow decrypt it while still passing it along in, you know, encrypted fashion to the end user so that no one on either side knows that there's someone in the middle. It's generally something that is viewed as very, very bad to do in the tech space.
I mean,
it's a breach of trust and a breach of the encryption. Like, if you're doing this, you're basically gaining access to information that you're not supposed to have access to because it's encrypted.
It's a tool that we would expect a hacker who's trying to gain access to a bunch of sensitive information to utilize, not a multinational corporation who's trying to dig up information on their competitors. I think that's fair to say. Like, I recognize that this is a ruthless industry, but I'm trying to think of the comparison of what this is like. I mean, this is opening your competitor's mail and reading through it before forwarding it on, but worse.
Mike, the fact that they're doing it on Snapchat and not the Bank of America app is the only thing that's preventing everyone from being very upset about this, because Snapchat.
Right.
If you're doing this on like something that's encrypted, like a bank like app or something like that,
yeah,
it's you have access to all the financial information,
right? And then, you know, other regulators that actually regulate the banking space get involved, and that might be part of our problem here. Is I don't know that there is a law that prohibits Facebook from attempting to unencrypt message traffic from Snapchat users. Do you?
I have no idea. I have no idea what the legislation is.
There should be.
But, like, I'll quote here again. So Facebook, by the way, in 2013 had bought a company called Anavo, which is similar to a virtual private network of VPN, but not. I don't know the specifics, but they bought this company back in 2013. After Zuckerberg's email, the Anavo team took the project and a month later proposed a solution. So-called kits that could be installed on iOS and Android that intercept traffic for specific subdomains, allowing us to read what would otherwise be encrypted traffic so we can measure in-app usage. So basically, the way a VPN works, if you're not familiar with it is a program that you install on a device. It can be a computer, a phone, or anything else that pretends that you are somewhere that you are not. So it allows you, typically, companies use it so that you can gain access to files on a company server without actually being in the office. It just seems to the server that you are, so you have access to it. So what this is basically doing, again, it's VPN-like from, I don't know the specifics, so don't ask me, but it's, hey, I am the end user, and so give me access to this encrypted data. This is wrong on so many freaking levels.
I'm trying to think of the non-tech equivalent of this. Like, what would be akin to this in the 1980s or 70s? To me, it's like Macy's, when Walmart was coming up and, you know, suddenly going to be competing with them, saying, you know what, this is a up-and-comer, we're a little bit worried about them. Let's start opening everyone's physical mail, reading through it to figure out where they are shopping and why this store is getting so popular. Like, this violation of any semblance of privacy and trust is appalling, and again, not surprising, given Zuckerberg and Facebook and the complete lack of ethical guidance that company has. But you encrypt a message because you don't want it to be read and intercepted. And unless that message is about your plans for terrorist activities, I think that we should all have a general expectation that it can't be recovered.
And by the way, one of the major things that Facebook has done in the last 4 years, back in 2020, they made WhatsApp, which is their communications app that gets used all over the world. They moved to use end-to-end encryption with it because they didn't want people to be, like, authorities and random people to be able to intercept messages between individuals. So, like, Facebook is like, no, we prioritize privacy for this, but by the way, if someone else is trying to do it, yeah, we're going to try to hack the crap out of them.
The most damning part is the email that has been quoted from Mark Zuckerberg on the subject, really effectively telling them to do this.
Yes, this is it. Whenever someone asks a question about Snapchat, the answer is usually because their traffic is encrypted, we have no analytics about them. Given how quickly they're growing, it seems important to figure out a new way to get reliable analytics. Perhaps we need to do panels or write custom software. You should figure out how to do this. Now, this then goes on to say, inside Facebook, there wasn't a consensus as to whether Project Ghostbusters was a good idea. Some employees, including Jay Parikh, Facebook's then head of infrastructure engineering, and Pedro Kanahuti, then head of security engineering, expressed their concern. Quote, I can't think of a good argument for why this is okay. No security person is ever comfortable with this, no matter what consent we get from the general public. The general public just doesn't know how this stuff works. Well, if you're not okay with it, then you quit. That's how it works. If there's something that's this egregious, and you're the head of freaking security engineering, you quit.
You quit and you tell authorities.
Yes.
You blow the whistle.
And
I think, but let me put myself in their shoes right now. If I blow the whistle on this company, I have zero confidence whatsoever that lawmakers will understand the problem and actually prosecute them.
Well, that's not a good reason to not
it's
do
not.
Something.
It's not. But, man, that is disheartening.
You know. So, this is really bad, Mike. I mean, this is the kind of stuff that you should end up with, like, an FTC consent decree where Facebook basically has to agree to, like, dismantle any operations related to external apps and not allow sharing of data inside or outside of its ecosystem and not access any data from anyone other than themselves. Like, this is how bad this is.
Nobody cares, by the way.
I know no one cares. You know,
Stock's barely moving today. Like, nobody gives a damn about this, and it is... If you don't use it, Snapchat, you should be insulted by this.
Right, because, look, if Facebook is saying, hey, this is something that normally... Again, they're head of security engineering. Quote, no security person is ever comfortable with this, no matter what consent we get from the general public. I can't think of a good argument for why this is okay. That's their own head of security saying, no, there's no reason that this is ever okay. And they did it anyways. They did it anyways.
Yeah, it's hard to believe.
So, there's that.
Well, you can... Yeah, the only real conclusion I have here is that lawmakers are bought and paid for by companies like this, and we continue to have zero common sense legislation when it comes to large tech companies in the United States, in spite of the fact that they continuously do things that any other industry would be put in prison for.
Tucker, do we have a guest next segment or is the segment after? I'm getting
segment
conflicting
after.
Reports.
Segment
okay.
After, yeah.
Let's take a quick break here. When we return, we've got trivia after this.
Text us 617-362-1385 with your comments and questions about today's show. And let us know what you think about the stories we're covering. This is the Financial Exchange Radio Network. A sound estate plan has many layers. In some cases, using a life estate can be a beneficial piece of your plan, but they also can be problematic. Call Cushing & Dolan, the experts in elder law, at 866-848-5699 and request their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. In it, you'll learn about the significant issues that life estates can cause, including the possibility of losing control of your estate. Building the proper estate plan not only protects your assets from the nursing home, but also helps you avoid probate and potentially eliminates estate taxes. So be aware of the many problems life estates can cause before you create one. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates.
That's 866-848-5699. Or you can request the guide online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. That's LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated. Is there anything better than sitting on a beautiful beach watching the sunset with an ice-cold drink? You can experience that right now by booking your next vacation to the United States Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John are all unique in their own special way. And if you head to usvi.com, you can create the vacation of a lifetime. Whether it's the rich history of St. Croix, the pristine beaches of St. Thomas, or the spectacular nature of St. John, the USVI has a little bit of everything for today's traveler. Upon arrival, you'll fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no money to exchange, no passport required, and travel from New England could not be easier. Make your plans now by going to usvi.com. Whether it's a romantic getaway or a family vacation, the U.S. Virgin Islands has everything you need to enjoy. The vacation of paradise is waiting for you. So head to visit usvi.com for more information and to reserve your trip today. That's visit usvi.com.
Hi, folks. Susan Powers and Chuck Sauda here from the Armstrong Advisory Group, and we're talking today about our brand new guide for the month of March, Building a Financial Plan. Chuck, when it comes to building a comprehensive financial plan, what components should you include?
Well, I think you have to look at all of the big ticket items to make sure that you're accounting for them. So things like, do you want to retire, and what's the timeline on which you want to retire? What's your plan for housing? Are you planning on renting and just allocating a portion of your income on a monthly basis to rent, or do you want to be buying a place, and that needs to be one of the goals that you integrate into your plan? Other things might depend on whether or not you have children, like saving for educational expenses or things like that. And then obviously, you might have other things that pop up along the way as well. Smaller things, hey, do you need to save for a vacation next year, or things along those lines.
So what's the best way, Chuck, to go about defining your goals?
Well, I think you really need to think about what's actually important to you in terms of how you want to live your life. It's not so much a financial discussion at first, but more thinking about what you actually want to do with your life. So if you say, look, I'd love to spend my time down in Florida more often, okay, that can get you thinking about whether you need to rent a place down there, buy a place, or some combination depending on what your life circumstances look like. So I think that's a great place to be starting.
Folks, learn how you can develop a comprehensive financial plan to help you pursue your goals, whether they are modest or substantial. Call right now to request your free copy of our brand new guide, Building a Financial Plan, at 800-393-4001. That's 800-393-4001. Or request your free copy at armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services. The Financial Exchange is now available on your Alexa smart speaker. Ask to play the Financial Exchange and catch up on anything you might have missed. This is the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
All right, time for trivia here on the Financial Exchange, and it's brought to you by Applebee's. Choose from a variety of half-price late-night appetizers after 9 p.m., including half-price boneless buffalo wings, half-price spinach and artichoke dip, and half-price warm pretzels dipped in beer cheese. Gather with friends any day of the week at Applebee's and say hello to half-price appetizers served late night, because half-off is just more fun. Now that's eating good in the neighborhood, void where prohibited, dine-in only. Well, did you know that 30% of the countries on Earth drive on the left side of the road? The United Kingdom, Japan, and India are probably the countries most associated with driving on the left side, but there is actually somewhere a part of the United States territory where you must drive on the left side of the road. Trivia question today, where's the only place in United States territory where you must drive on the left side of the road? Once again, where's the only place in the United States territory where you must drive on the left side of the road? Be the second person today to text us at 617-362-1385 with the correct answer, and win a Financial Exchange Show t-shirt and be registered to win a $100 gift card to Applebee's. Be sure to include the keyword Applebee's in your text, And we'll give away that Applebee's gift card on tomorrow's show. 617-362-1385. And the second correct response will be our winner. See complete contest rules at financialexchangeshow.com.
Mike, let's talk a little bit about college costs. Piece in the Boston Globe-a-rooney that for the first time, sticker prices for tuition plus room and board are exceeding $90,000 a year at a number of New England colleges.
Sweet mother of God. I know that we shouldn't be surprised that we've gotten here because I feel like it was yesterday they were talking about prices hitting like 70,000, but I'm sure that was a decade ago or maybe just 4 years ago. And yeah, here we are.
So basically what this means is if you want to send your kids to these schools, you're talking for 4 years, $400,000.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have seen at some of them some movements on financial aid that basically means that like these tuitions are not real for large portions of the population. My own alma mater, just as an example, Dartmouth, just received a $150 million gift that is now making tuition fully covered for any family making under $125,000 a year. Not every school can do that, though.
Yep.
But it's look, I think that stuff is great. But you've got the highest one here, Tufts, which is coming in with total estimated cost for undergraduate student for a year, coming in at $95,888. $70,000 for tuition and fees and $25,000 for living expenses, which includes housing, food, and textbooks. Your thoughts, Michael?
I guess my thoughts are that there are many other colleges and universities around the country that will be in this range. I haven't looked at NYU, but I see Boston University was pointed out here as also being over $90,000. I'm sure Harvard All In is there, Boston College, and many others.
Go ahead.
No, please.
It's noted in here that most people don't pay these prices.
That is true. Like, if you are a family making probably under like $400,000, maybe not quite that, but you know, $250,000 a year, most people are not going to face those full prices. You're going to get some form of financial assistance, but I don't know. I'm not sure that I really. Not really sure I care. Like, your list price is still your list price.
But here's why the list price exists, Mike, is so that they can provide discounts.
Yep.
But still charge the people that can pay full boat
yep.
the price they need in order to run the school. So U.S. News and World Report has, for example, Boston University, which is included in here. If you are a family making $0 to $30,000 a year, the net price, okay, excluding loans, so this is like what they basically grant you, is $11,000 a year. So you'd have to take out about $11,000 in loans a year.
Mm-hmm.
If you are making $48,000 to $75,000, your net price is $15,000 a year. $75,000 to $110,000, your average price is around $23,000 a year. And $110,000 plus, your average price is $46,000 a year.
Yeah.
So again, it's not to say, hey, like, this is great because no one pays this, but these sticker prices are there so that, hey, for the wealthy son or daughter of a foreign business person who wants to put their name on a building, great, you're going to be paying $90,000 a year. And that's going to help us to subsidize the people that are paying less.
Yeah, I guess that's all true. I guess I would just also... Here are a couple things that I would point out. I don't think that this many universities can survive with list prices like this because, to your point, there are plenty of universities out there that don't have the endowments of BU, BC,
totally.
And Dartmouth that won't be able to offer these types of discounts and are going to end up charging way too much and putting themselves out of business if they don't change their overall structure. We also happen to have the most expensive college, whether it is discounted and subsidized with grants and scholarships or not, across the globe, some of the most expensive education. Some of the best education, too, but some of the most expensive. And the list of schools that I can think of that are probably worth it, right? If you think about, like, having to pay full boat and then pay that back and your earnings increase off of that, it's not 1,000. It's more than 10.
It's probably 20 to 25.
I think it might be a little bit more than that, but not by much. And I think that has to be the consideration here is if you're paying $75,000 for an education that is not going to give you the, really it's the connections that I'm focusing in on here.
Totally.
That Harvard and Dartmouth and some of these schools grant, then you really do have to question what exactly am I getting out of this? And how long is that institution going to be able to survive? I worry about that when I hear about these, like, you know, charitable endowment pensions that people are getting from some of these institutions. It's like, you know, that place has to still.
We are the Debt Destroyer Network. Any debt you have, credit card, tax, student loan debt. Call now for free information that helps you destroy your debt. It's great advice. Plus, when you make this free call now, we have debt destroyer experts ready to help. They can show you how to destroy your debt and get your life back on track. Debt problems don't have to be overwhelming. You can live stress-free and debt-free. Credit cards, medical bills, IRS tax problems, even student loan debt. Learn about free programs offered by the credit card companies, hospitals, and even the government that can help slash your debt. Call the Debt Destroyer now for free information. Call now. 800-430-8804. 800-430-8804. 800-430-8804. Again, that's 800-430-8804. 8804.
To be engaged, you must feel included and valued. The DAV Department of Massachusetts nurtures a culture where inclusiveness is a reflex, not an initiative, where there's a deep sense of pride, passion, and belonging that is unified in our shared commitment, dedication, and patriotism for our country. We know through experience that different ideas, perspectives, and backgrounds create a stronger and more creative organization that delivers better results for the veterans and families we strive to assist. For more information, visit DAVMA.org.
There are many ways to protect your assets from the nursing home. If you use a life estate, that can create problems, including the possibility of losing control over your estate. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699 or request it online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated.
Everyone has financial goals, and regardless of what yours are, the process of establishing a comprehensive financial plan is key to achieving them. This is Chuck Zahn from the Armstrong Advisory Group, and our new guide called Building a Financial Plan may help. Some goals are bigger than others, like saving for retirement, but even smaller goals like paying off your credit card debt can be an important part of a well-rounded financial plan. As you build your plan, break your goals down into realistic tasks, establish a saving strategy, or determine an asset allocation that aligns with your risk tolerance. It's also important to create checkpoints to help you monitor your progress and make sure your plan remains on track. Call us today at 800-393-4001 and ask for our new guide called Building a Financial Plan. That's 800-393-4001, or you can request it at armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services.
This is Tucker Silva of the Financial Exchange Show, and I'm joined today by estate planning attorney Todd Lutsky from the law firm of Cushing & Dolan, with your financial exchange quick tip of the day. And today, we're talking about the use of life estates and your primary residence. Todd, what are the pitfalls associated with creating a life estate when you transfer the remainder interest to your children?
Yeah, you know, this is the most common way people create life estates. It seems easy, it seems simple, but it's not the best way to create a life estate. Once you put your children's name on the deed, you give up a lot of control. Like, you can't change your mind later if you want to leave it to one child versus another who might be taking care of you later. You have problems if you want to go to sell it, right? You might have the right to live there, but if you want to go to sell it, you're going to need the permission of the children in order to sign off on the remainder interest of the deed. And then even if they do sell it and you get their permission, a larger chunk of the proceeds are going to end up in the hands of the child rather than you. That creates adverse income tax consequences to the child. Plus, you, who sold the house, might need the money to buy another house or a downsized house or move, all of which create problems, never mind creditor problems for the children while they're living. Folks, don't do the life estate this way because it seems to create more trouble than it's worth.
Learn how you can avoid probate, eliminate estate taxes, keep your money in your family, and protect your assets from the nursing home. Request this brand new guide from Cushing & Dolan. It's called Calculating the Consequences of a Life Estate. Call 866-848-5699. That's 866-848-5699. Or you can simply request it from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com.
The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated. Miss any of the show? The Financial Exchange Show podcast is available on Apple, Spotify, and iHeartRadio. Hit the subscribe button and leave us a five-star review. This is the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
Trivia question today was, where's the only place on United States territory where you must drive on the left side of the road? Well, that would be the United States Virgin Islands. Frank from York, Maine, taking home our Financial Exchange Show t-shirt. And Frank's also registered to win a $100 gift card to Applebee's, which we'll give away on tomorrow's show. And trivia is brought to you by Applebee's. Choose from a variety of half-priced late-night appetizers after 9 p.m. because half-off is just more fun. Now that's eating good in the neighborhood. Void where prohibited. Dine in only.
Speaking of which, the Commissioner of Tourism for the United States Virgin Islands, Joe Bisciolti, joins us on the program right now. And I have to say, Joe, you manage to time your visits perfectly. Every time you come and talk to us, it is pouring rain and 40 degrees out or snowing. So, you know, I think that's actually the best time for you probably come on the program and talk to us about the United States Virgin Islands.
Yeah, I think that definitely helps us get people interested in wanting to leave the area today. I know it's opening season for the baseball.
Yeah, fair.
But I could tell you, I mean, it's a good thing the Red Sox are probably on the road today. I don't know if the game would have gotten in. But when I landed near midnight last night, I looked outside. I was like, wow.
Here I am.
That is a big change. But thank you for having me. We always appreciate coming in town. Of course, always good to stop in when I'm here in town for some other meetings.
No doubt.
And so happy to be here, even though it's cold and rainy.
So talk to us. I've personally actually, believe it or not, never been to St. Thomas, and I know the carnival is coming up there. Yep. I know nothing about it, so let's start at square one. You know, how long is the event? What's it like for folks that have or haven't been to St. Thomas?
So St. Thomas Carnival is one of our biggest cultural events, so it gives people an opportunity to come in. It's basically a week-long activity where there's nightly free concerts with the biggest soca stars, which is the Caribbean soca version reggae concerts that happen every night. And then we have almost like a country fair kind of setup. So there are booths that have local food, drinks that are all in a big rectangle on a big stage at the one end. And then we also have two big parades that happen at the end. Those are on May 3rd and 4th, one for the children and one for the adults. We have a new attraction this year that hasn't happened in 7 years. Our horse racetrack has just recently opened up. So they're going to be horse racing there. So the BVI is coming in. St. Croix is going to be in. St. Thomas is going to be in. So that's expected to be massive for us. And then one of the other big, big events is Juve, which is on May 2nd. And all of these activities are in downtown Charlotte Amalie, St. Thomas, where we expect to have thousands and thousands of people. We call it tramping or masquerading on the street to live bands and DJs from 4 o'clock in the morning till 12 o'clock noon.
Are there casinos on St. Thomas? I know there's one on St. Croix, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, they're not full-blown casinos, so they're video casinos. Yep. So they have them around basically machines.
Yeah, yeah.
But in St. Croix, there's full-blown casinos, so table games and the slots.
Talk to us about the part of tourism, you know, where to stay on the islands. And I'm not going to make you choose between the beautiful resorts and the beautiful rental homes on there. But I know there's a lot of both. And I know in particular, you were just featured for, you know, some of the homes on St. Thomas that are available for rent. What's the availability if you're looking for a vacation? Maybe it's just a couple. Maybe it's a family of five. Like, how do you evaluate this?
We, as a tourism lead, we actually in a very strong boom period. So the last 3 weeks, you know, tied in with spring break, tied in with the weather in the continental U.S. that's been kind of flaky.
Terrible.
Yeah,
Terrible. Bad skiing weather. Bad. It's been pretty bad.
So we've actually had three of our best weeks since COVID. I mean, we were open during COVID.
Wow.
Really strong. Many of the days we had capacity. But fortunately for us, we just had a brand new property open up, which used to be the flagship property for St. Thomas, which is the French Prince Reef. It used to be a Marriott, but it reopened as a Westin and an Autograph Collection, almost 500 rooms. That's just recently opened up. And then we continue to be one of the few destinations in the Caribbean that have more sharing economy inventory rooms than traditional hotel rooms.
Okay.
So very strong Airbnb, VRBO, home away from home. So if you're a person that appreciates to stay in a sharing economy place as opposed to a traditional hotel, the inventory is quite big. We also know, like, so the week at Carnival we just spoke about is very, very tough because basically everything is sold out or almost sold out. Flights are coming in. You know, one of the things I was just speaking with one of your coworkers on is that we've added new lift from the Boston area. So JetBlue has increased a second day in direct flight into the territory. Of course, Delta, American Connect, United Connect out of the area.
I wanted to ask about that because, you know, nationwide we're hearing about the Boeing issues and how a lot of airlines are not getting the inventory of planes they need. They're cutting back some routes in some key areas. But from what I understand, you're hearing, you know, kind of doubling down a commitment from the major airlines.
Yeah,
to the
I think it's a testament to, you know, clearly some of the strategic marketing moves we've made in creating our brand awareness. As you know, we have an agreement, partnership with the Boston Red Sox,
sure,
Friendly Sports Marketing, of course, the stuff we do with you. So the awareness has been building in this Boston area actually for 3 or 4 years that we've been doing. And now we're starting to see the dividends where our flights in from JetBlue Direct are coming in at 98% capacity.
Wow.
At a yield. So this area clearly is supporting us in the USVI, and we thank everybody for doing that. We met with our airline partners last week, and the consensus with the airlines, not just JetBlue that flies direct, but the other airlines that fly in, are saying, you know, the Boston area is strong for us. So we're grateful. I think the other thing that's been happening is we continue to push our brand as we are a U.S. territory.
Mm.
So everything that you have in Boston in terms of U.S. dollar, cell phone works, access to high quality health care if you get sick, things that we used to take for granted before COVID,
sure,
still play now. And I think people recognize that there is always access in and out because the airports and seaports have federal oversight. So you get in and out, you don't have a problem coming to the USVI. And I think the last thing I would say is that we continue to be very, you know, we are a well-run tourism destination. So when you come in, services quality, you want to be left alone, you can stay alone. You want to mingle with the local people, you could do that. You want to do a combination, you can do that. And we're very safe. So I think people continue to see that. So if you want a vacation or you just want to get away, we definitely have all options for you.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was talking to somebody the other day who brought up a headline in the Bahamas of something terrible that had happened there. And maybe you can just reiterate, I think a lot of people do know the United States Virgin Islands, but, you know, we're talking about the islands of St. John, St. Thomas, and St. Croix.
Right.
And to your point, the benefits of those being a U.S. territory, right? I don't think you even need a passport to come in.
No passport necessary, which is huge. No passport necessary. And I think one of the things we always state, particularly when I'm on the road a lot, one, that no passport, most people don't even know that, right?
Right. So they're like, nowhere else in the Caribbean you can travel to without a passport.
I think the second thing that we tell people that's surprising is almost over 60% of U.S. Citizens don't have a passport. So we we always have the, you know, that one uncle or aunt, you're doing that trip, or that one friend, and you're like, hey, we going. Oh, I don't have a passport.
Talk to you in 6 months.
Exactly. So you come to the U.S. Valley, you don't have to worry about that.
Right.
I think that the other thing that we have that's been strong for us is we continually have been building our product out. So when you get in there, you know, if there are things to do in the day, there are attractions to do in the evening. And, of course, we have some of the best beaches in the world and beautiful waters to go out on. So I think people, when they say you want a vacation, it's a great place to be. We continue to be pushing in terms of our cultural and the ability for experiences, because I think one of the things that we have evolved as a destination over the last probably decade or so, we used to be a big shopping cruise port, and we still latest ranked number one in total spend in cruise in the Caribbean in total spend. But what we're finding now is more and more people are not necessarily coming in to buy jewelry. What they want to do is spend in terms of emerging into the culture and the experience of the islands. And the other thing that continues to let me know that the millennials and Gen Z are coming strong is if you don't have a strong quote-unquote postcard Instagram site visits, people are upset. I want to remember this trip. You need to have nice stuff set up that they could take that snap and post up on Snapchat or wherever they post. So we've been doing a good job of making those things more available. And surprisingly,
it's important.
When you put them up, you'd be really surprised how many times you drive by a certain spot and you're like, oh my gosh, look at all those people lining up to take a picture.
It's wild. I know it's true. I've seen it before, and it's definitely the case. We've been talking with Joe Bisciolti. He's the commissioner for the United States Virgin Islands Department of Tourism. He was talking to us in particular about the St. Thomas Carnival coming up April 28th through May 5th. If you don't already have a room booked, well, might already be too late, quite honestly, but a big event coming up, a big cultural event, a lot of stuff to do down there coming up, and in my experience,
we actually the next big cultural festival moves to St. John, right around 4th of July. So that may be the next move. You can't do it. You can't do Carnival plan for St. John in end of June, and it finishes on July 4th.
It's again Joe Bisciolti, the Commissioner for Tourism for the United States Virgin Islands, joins us today to talk a little bit about the goings on down there. Joe, thanks so much for joining us. Appreciate it, and we'll catch up with you again soon.
Thank you.
Quick break. Some Stack Roulette for you is next on the Financial Exchange.
Miss any of the show? Catch up at your convenience by visiting financialexchangeshow.com and clicking the on-demand icon, where you'll find all of our interviews and full shows. This is your home for the latest business and financial news in New England and around the country. This is the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
With the stock market remaining volatile, it couldn't be more important to have a sound financial plan. I'm Mike Armstrong from the Armstrong Advisory Group. There are risks with any investment strategy, and that's why we've written a brand new guide to help you understand those risks and how they can be associated with any financial decision. It's called Building a Financial Plan, and it may help you recognize the potential risks and rewards that are associated with your investment strategy, in addition to offering insight into how to research making the decisions that are best suited for you and your family. The guide also provides information on how to establish clear financial goals and what steps might be needed in order to achieve them. Call us today at 800-393-4001 and ask for your free guide today. That number again is 800-393-4001, or you can request it online at armstrongadvisory.com.
The proceeding was paid for by Armstrong Advisory Group, a registered investment advisor. Nothing in the ad or in any Armstrong guide is specific financial, legal, or tax advice. Consult your own financial, tax, and estate planning advisors before making any investment decisions. Armstrong may contact you to offer investment advisory services.
To be engaged, you must feel included and valued. The DAV Department of Massachusetts nurtures a culture where inclusiveness is a reflex, not an initiative, where there's a deep sense of pride, passion, and belonging that is unified in our shared commitment, dedication, and patriotism for our country. We know through experience that different ideas, perspectives, and backgrounds create a stronger and more creative organization that delivers better results for the veterans and families we strive to assist. For more information, visit DAVMA.org.
There are many ways to protect your assets from the nursing home. If you use a life estate, that can create problems, including the possibility of losing control over your estate.
Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699 or request it online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated. Is there anything better than sitting on a beautiful beach watching the sunset with an ice-cold drink? You can experience that right now by booking your next vacation to the United States Virgin Islands. St. Croix, St. Thomas, and St. John are all unique in their own special way. And if you head to usvi.com, you can create the vacation of a lifetime. Whether it's the rich history of St. Croix, the pristine beaches of St. Thomas, or the spectacular nature of St. John, the USVI has a little bit of everything for today's traveler. Upon arrival, you'll fall naturally in rhythm with the heartbeat of the islands. There's no money to exchange, no passport required, and travel from New England could not be easier. Make your plans now by going to usvi.com. Whether it's a romantic getaway or a family vacation, the U.S. Virgin Islands has everything you need to enjoy. The vacation of paradise is waiting for you. So head to visit usvi.com for more information and to reserve your trip today. That's visit usvi.com. A sound estate plan has many layers. In some cases, using a life estate can be a beneficial piece of your plan, but they also can be problematic. Call Cushing & Dolan, the experts in elder law, at 866-848-5699 and request their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. In it, you'll learn about the significant issues that life estates can cause, including the possibility of losing control of your estate. Building the proper estate plan not only protects your assets from the nursing home, but also helps you avoid probate and potentially eliminates estate taxes. So be aware of the many problems life estates can cause before you create one. Call Cushing & Dolan today at 866-848-5699 and get their new guide called Calculating the Consequences of Life Estates. That's 866-848-5699. Or you can request the guide online from their website, LegalExchangeShow.com. That's LegalExchangeShow.com. The proceeding was paid for and the views expressed are solely those of Cushing & Dolan. Cushing & Dolan and or Armstrong Advisory may contact you offering legal or investment services. Cushing & Armstrong do not endorse each other and are not affiliated.
Breaking business news as it happens, only here on the Financial Exchange Radio Network.
All of us at the Financial Exchange are truly thankful for our partnership with the Disabled American Veterans Department of Massachusetts. You can help our great American heroes too by making a donation today. Your gifts can support the Veteran Advancement Program, which offers permanent and affordable housing opportunities for veterans and their dependents. Learn more at DAV5K.Boston. The DAV 5K Boston is presented by Veterans Development Corporation.
Mike, what do you have for stack roulette for me?
Wasn't in the stack, but Sam Bankman-Fried has been sentenced to 25 years in prison, is some breaking news that we just saw run across the Bloomberg right now.
I saw 20.
You saw 20? Didn't we just see 25, Tucker?
I just saw 25 on Bloomberg. So
CNBC's reporting 20.
Well, maybe it's 22 years.
How do we arbitrage this?
I'd go Bloomberg if I had to trust one over the other, but
let me see what Twitter's saying. That'll be the tiebreaker.
Yeah. For some sort of benchmark here, Bernie Madoff was sentenced to, what did we say, 150 years in prison,
yes.
Tucker?
Yep.
So much lighter sentence than that, but this will put him...
Twitter has 25, so...
Okay. So I think we go with that. I think one of the fascinating pieces on this is that there are now some estimates, in fact, that... SBF's victims may actually be made whole because of the most recent run-up in Bitcoin, which, of course, could collapse tomorrow. But based on where things are right now, the assets that they have seized from FTX are considerably more valuable when this all broke apart, which is also an interesting thought exercise of if you hadn't gone through that bout of volatility, would anyone have ever known that he was perpetuating this fraud? Probably not for years.
Probably not, but here's the other piece that you have to remember is the make whole amount is based on the valuation on the date of.
Yeah, not the value that it would have been worth today.
So let's say that you held one Bitcoin with FTX in October of 22 and it was worth $19,000. Today it's worth $71,000. You are not getting $71,000. So you do lose that whole opportunity cost of actually being able to do something with the money over that time span.
Very true. Yeah, I don't really have any commentary on what's fair in this case. 25 years, it's a long period of time, and I think the obvious comparison has to be to Bernie Madoff. They're similar types of frauds that were perpetuated with very different types of victims and very different types of tools that were used. But yeah, that seems like at least the start to the end of a bit of a saga here.
Tucker, I want to talk to you about this sports betting story that made it in here from the Wall Street Journal. America made a huge bet on sports gambling. The backlash is here. In the last week, we've had a case with Shohei Ohtani, who is not directly accused of doing anything, but basically his translator is now accused by him of stealing $4.5 million that was wired out of Shohei Ohtani's account to an illegal bookie in California where bookmaking is not yet legalized.
Which I don't understand how an interpreter gets access to one's finances, but that's neither here nor there.
You'd be surprised. I mean, professional athletes, in terms of who they delegate like powers to for their finances.
Their interpreter?
I mean, look, it's a case where if you are from a foreign country, your interpreter might be your best friend that you're with.
All right.
I know that I forget who the... I think Baker Mayfield right now is suing his parents for $12 million that they stole out of his account.
Whoops.
It's either his parents or his brother or sister. Like, it's a very close family member that he's embroiled in a lawsuit because they took like $12 million out of his account. So I don't know whether Ohtani's guilty of anything or not, but it's neither here nor there. He's the most famous baseball player on the planet, and he now has a big question mark about whether or not he was betting on sports and betting on baseball. Also this week, Jonte Porter, who makes $415,000 a year, basically sitting on a bench in an NBA for an NBA team, was found to have been running a Discord server, which is basically it's like an app or a website, promoting different NBA bets. And this comes on the back of several $20,000 bets trying to be placed for whether or not he would score fewer than 3 points in a game, in which those games he ended up removing himself for the game after like 2 minutes, claiming very minor injuries. So there's all kinds of suspicion there now. Yeah, it's...
Like, be more obvious. What are you doing?
I just don't know how we can get dumber than that.
Listen, guys, I don't know that anyone should be shocked. Like, these are professional athletes. They are hired for their athletic ability, and I'm not sure that we should be surprised by behavior that we think is irrational.
No, but that's not the problem here. The problem here is, what are we watching? Are we actually watching sports where we're trying to watch people compete at the highest possible level? Or are we watching a bunch of athletes trying to make a few extra bucks on the side through gambling?
It's a scary question for sports leagues out there.
And I don't know how you put this genie back in the bottle, because the sports leagues themselves are causing the problems. Every other ad everywhere is DraftKings or FanDuel or BetMGM or ESPN Bet or this and that. And then you've got players being like, well, I literally have a logo on my jersey telling me to bet, and I can't, like, what gives, man? It's very not good, and I'm curious your take on it, Tucker.
No, I mean, it's obviously going to be a problem that's the teams themselves or the leagues themselves have to address. Like, I still don't understand how a player can, a bench player, mind you, can place a wager on his under points for a player prop, knowing that he's a bench player. Like, obviously the under is going to hit. Like, what are you doing? I want to say, like, insert more knowledge here, but like, that's just dumb. That's just plain dumb. But yeah, they're just gonna have to, I don't know, filter their phones for these apps. Like, I don't know the workaround. I don't know, but it's gotta stop.
Yeah, it's, well, but even there, okay, I'm gonna send the money to a friend and they can place the bet.
Yeah, you have to have like dire consequences. Be like banned for life, something like that.
I don't know how you deal with it otherwise.
I don't know how else.
Take a quick break. We're back tomorrow to finish up the week here on the Financial Exchange.